Welcome to our very first entertainment show, Rendez-Vous. I'm Norma.
And I'm Stephanie.
A Rendez-Vous is a show that will try to give you as much information as we can about what's happening in Montreal. Isn't that right, Steph?
That's right, Norma. In fact, we'll have features, information about Concordia, and all kinds of reviews on movies, music, the theater, or whatever's happening around town and our campus.
Our first feature is the Terry Fox Bash. Five Montreal bands performed at this bash in order to raise money for cancer research. The five bands included the Black Cadillacs, Spectre 12, Off Limits, Aiken Spanner, and the Missing Kids. Our Rendez-Vous entertainment crew were there, and let's see what they have to offer.
Craig, what led you to organize this show?
Well, I had a couple of people in my family that died of cancer, you know, and I think it's a really horrible disease. My grandfather died a really long, lingering death, and I just thought that because I'd never done anything before in form of charity, I thought that it would be nice to put together something that I could use my talents and also have, you know, some friends of mine that were in the other bands come out and do the show.
Was it hard getting the other groups to participate?
Well, that was the easiest part. It was the easiest part. The bands were right into the cause right from the beginning, and they just wanted to make sure that everything would be organized really well. And that's about all that they were really concerned with. They're not even, like, you know, they're not even charging for the event. All the bands are playing free of charge.
A very, very good singer. If you see resemblance here with her hair, any artist comes up to mind, I would say would be. Who do you look like there, Sue?
A lot like Madonna.
I would say that too. Okay. A little bit like Dolly Parton, your style of music?
That too. Okay.
Still a market out there for your style of music, that it's still rock and roll? Do you see that there is still a following there?
Definitely.
Why do you say that?
Why? Because you have older people. Not older people, because I'm older people too. Everybody's old.
How old are you?
26.
Old.
Yeah. Thanks. I mean, it's the roots. It's the roots of the music that we listen to today. It all started from the 50s, the 40s, the 50s, 60s, working its way up. And it's all the music that everybody recognizes. You can be in high school today and people hear, "I'll shake it up, baby, now." And they just want, they go right away.
Yeah.
They want to dance.
It brings it all back. Yeah. Everybody likes to remember all that time.
They know the words. They don't really know the song, but they want to, they still know what's going on. You know?
That's very good. Okay, do you foresee a cult following? Couldn't think of a question.
A cult following?
Cult following.
As in groupies and
yeah.
things like that?
Exactly.
Not really, no.
Yeah.
No.
Well, you're four very handsome young men, so I'm surprised at that.
Well, we have a lot of friends who back us up. Well, we're from the West Island, as you know.
Uh-oh, yeah.
Norm grew up.
I believe that. Interviewing tonight is Inspector 12. They have been categorized as very different, but very, very funny. Okay, to my right is?
Ex-Benedict.
Ex-Benedict. And to my left?
Tuesday Abobo.
Okay, I'm curious to know where you got this name. Can you tell me where you got this name?
Well, you know, my master, Bill Wednesday, he was shipwrecked and he found me. And then he brought me back to North America, but he called me Tuesday Wednesday. Because the North Americans do not understand Abobo. So now I am known as Tuesday Wednesday.
Very, very interesting.
So this is a Western punk jazz tune.
Style of music, I'm going to ask them what type of music they do sing and where they got their inspiration. Can you tell me this?
Yes. Okay, we play funk, jazz, punk, western style, classical. We got it basically from Julio Iglesias.
Okay, so I guess he was your inspiration then.
Here, here, yes.
Yeah.
Yeah.
fellow students are really talented and we don't even realize it. I'm sure there are a lot of things happening on campus that we don't even realize. Wouldn't you agree, Norma?
I agree. Like the art gallery, for example, located right on the second floor mezzanine at the hall building. That's why we decided to take a long look at the art gallery. Let's see.
Concordia faculty and students don't have to go very far to see professional art exhibits. Since 1966, Concordia owns its own art gallery, which easily compares in quality to other galleries in and around Montreal. The Concordia Art Gallery is located on the mezzanine floor of the hall building. Works of artists can be seen in Gallery 1, in Gallery 2, as well as in the displays near the curator's office. Major exhibitions are located here in Gallery 1 because it is the largest of the two. The main characteristic of the gallery is that 90% of their exhibitions are on Canadian artists. Each of these exhibitions is on for approximately 6 weeks and will require specific lighting proper to the exhibition. Gallery 2 is sometimes forgotten by the public because of its awkward location and lack of advertising. It's to the far right of Gallery 1 and well worth the trouble of the extra steps. Perfectly suited for exhibitions, creating a certain intimate atmosphere. Concordia Art Gallery, like any other professional gallery or museum, owns a permanent art collection. It comprises an extensive survey of 19th and 20th century Canadian art. It includes paintings, drawings, photographs, and sculptures. African and pre-Columbian art are also part of the collection. Works of art from the collection suited for showcases can be seen in the displays near the curator's office. Canada Council and the National Museums of Canada are convinced of the gallery's top-level exhibitions, and through their support, the gallery has been able to complement a number of these exhibitions with a catalog. These catalogs, filled with scholarly information and visuals, are the perfect complement to the exhibitions. Not too many universities have their own art gallery. Concordia students and faculty have a great advantage. So if you haven't already done so, come and have a look at your gallery. It's open Monday to Fridays from 10 a.m. to 8 p.m., Saturdays from 10 a.m. to 5 p.m., and admission is free of charge. For Rendez-Vous, I'm Anne Sear.
Welcome back. Now we are joined by our very own film critic, Sunil Mitani. He's here to tell us about the latest movie by Francis Ford Coppola, Peggy Sue Got Married. Sunil, isn't the gorgeous blonde Kathleen Turner featured in this flick?
That's right. This is her very next movie after playing opposite Jack Nicholson in Prizzi's Honor last year. That was directed by John Huston.
I heard that it's somewhat similar to Back to the Future. Is that right?
Well, Stephanie, there are some elements that are similar. In Back to the Future, he went back in time, and in this one, she goes back into time. But otherwise, they're very different. Back to the Future was a terrific summer comedy. I laughed all the way through. But in Peggy Sue Got Married, it deals very much with emotions. It essentially asks the ultimate hypothetical question, if you could live your life over again, what would you do differently, and would it be any different? And Peggy Sue Got Married opens in the present. Peggy Sue's middle age is the worst time in her life. She's about to get a divorce from her husband, Charlie, and she's just feeling awful. And then she's thrust back into the past, into what was essentially the best time of her life when she was a teenager. She was 18 years old in 1960. She's thrust back into the best time of her life when she was a teenager, and she deals with relationships again with her family, her friends, and even her husband, Charlie. This next scene is around the breakfast table the night after she arrives.
You're looking bright and chipper this morning.
Well, I'm still here. I thought I might as well enjoy myself. I think I'll go to school today. You know, Dad, I'm sorry about yesterday. The Edsel is a classic. Use it in the best of health.
Well, thank you. But don't ever let anything like that happen again. You're far too young to start acquiring bad habits.
I agree. You know, Mom and Dad, you are the best parents a girl could ever have. I'm really gonna try and behave myself.
Sure you will.
Come on, Mom, sit down.
You want me to sit?
I mean, isn't this great? Just all of us here together? Oh.
Can I tell Charlie Peggy Sue got drunk last night?
Young lady.
I forgot about him. What am I gonna do?
What's the matter, Peggy? Did you two have a fight?
Sort of.
About what?
House payments.
That was good. The fact that Kathleen Turner knows exactly what's going to happen to her is pretty funny, wouldn't you
say? Yeah, exactly. And it's just those kind of jokes that provide most of the humor in this film. But another thing that makes it different from something like Back to the Future is that the dramatic elements in Peggy Sue Got Married are just as important, and for me, were more important in Peggy Sue Got Married. Just the fact that she knows that her life turned out to be miserable, she doesn't want that again, and yet she still finds herself falling in love with Charlie because he's so innocent in the past and so charming. And as far as the acting goes, both Kathleen Turner and Nicholas Clay, her co-star who plays Charlie, are guilty of some overacting at times, but thanks to the directing by Francis Coppola, they both turn in quite believable performances.
So now, what would you rate this movie on a scale of 1 to 10?
Scale of 1 to 10, I'd probably give this a 7. You just don't stop smiling in the whole movie. It's very well written with just the right touches of comedy and drama.
Thank you. Now, because it's Halloween week, we also have a special movie review called Trick or Treat. What do you think about that one, Sunil?
Trick or Treat, what a dud. It is bad, okay? It's about a lonely teenager who falls in love with this rock star who kills himself. Then because of this worship, the rock star comes back to life to help this teenager out. Yeah. Don't go see it.
I heard it's geared towards a more teenage audience. What would you say?
Actually, I think most of the teenagers that I know are probably more intelligent than to go see a movie like this. All about when the rock star comes back to life to supposedly help this teenager, he goes around killing everybody. He wants to kill his girlfriends, his boyfriends, his mother, everyone in sight. No.
Yeah.
It's not one to see. And the worst part about it is that they could have made a really good satirical comment on heavy metal music and what it does to children and the sexually suggestive lyrics and that, but it doesn't. It just goes in for cheap jokes and special effects, which are far from dazzling. I wouldn't recommend it at all.
Well, I'm really curious. Let's take a look at the clip.
Beast. What happened to the good old simple love song? I love you. That's a good word to use. Nowadays, they have to write some sickness. It's just absolutely sick and bizarre, and I'm going to do my utmost best to try and stop it now.
Anything you'd like to say in conclusion?
These evil people have just got to be stopped.
Thank you.
Well, enough about this. Let's talk about sex. Hey, not me. Shalini's here to talk to us about the decline of the American Empire. Shalini, I heard that this movie has received quite a few awards.
Well, Stephanie, as a matter of fact, it has, and I think it's well-deserved. It's won the Cannes Film Festival awards there. That's the Press International award that it won, and as well in Toronto at the Festival of Festivals, it was known to have won the awards. In New York now, it's getting a lot of accolades because really the Americans perhaps are looking to Canada to develop its own type of Canadian film. And even though the most Canadian thing about this film is its director, Denis Arcand, and the actors and actresses, as well as the locations and the little colloquialisms, it's really a theme of an adult theme on an international basis. It's not really French-Québécois as much as it is a pretty adult comedy, satire, a sensitive emotional portrayal.
So tell us a little bit about the plot.
Well, it begins with a group of men in a kitchen discussing their sexual exploits, and particularly one of the one who plays the husband, I think Remy Girard is his name, and we move on to scenes of his reminiscences and sexual exploits, and then we switch to who they're waiting for, and those are the wives and the girlfriends and associates. Now, all these people are together, both the groups are united with their common university teaching jobs. Mm-hmm. They're all in the same university teaching together. So these people have seen each other in the working milieu, and they're also very, very good friends. You see the women there when they're Nautilus equipment and jogging and talking about their little sexual exploits. And it's very interesting because now you find the men are waiting for the women to get home, and they're making the dinner waiting for the women. Almost
so
like
sort
a
of like reverse
it's
roles.
A reversal of the roles, and I wonder if that's like a switch back to Bergman when you see in some of his movies, Summer Paradise, where the women are waiting and talking at home, gossiping about their reminiscences and how they met, and it's kind of a reversal of that Bergman film. It's an interesting movie. It's basically about, it's more of a social type of social comment, perhaps on the hypocrisy, and you can argue whether it's debatable whether this person, Denis Arcand, through the eyes of this writer, who Dominique Michel is a writer, has these ideas that society is very hypocritical and she's going to expose it, and she does to very devastating effects. And now the themes are adultery, homosexuality, mm-hmm. You deal with everything, you name it, going out with a younger man, going out with an older woman, a young divorcee who's been through a sensitive crisis in her life, who finds that now she's not qualified to have any kind of a teaching position because she was at home taking care of the children, and her way of rebelling now is going out with a young rocker. It's an interesting movie. It's really worthwhile seeing. It makes you think about a lot of issues. It's debatable whether you'll agree with all the things that they say, but it's very beautifully done. It's a very sensitive portrayal of the different kinds of people. A little bit cliched sometimes, a little bit sometimes too raunchy to be believed, but I think it's a worthwhile film to see, and it's a definite tribute to Canada.
But Shalini, since the story takes place around women who talk about their sexual experiences, is the audience geared towards female or male or both?
Very much both, because you have the interrelationship between the two. Now, I think more than the women, I think it's the experiences or reminiscences of this one man, mm-hmm. The husband, that really come across very strongly. And then there's a homosexual that he's talking to, that there's another young professor who, you know, had a lot of flings beforehand, too. And then the writer is a central person around all these people, and she kind of ties in to being the best friend of the wife and having had serious knowledge, quote-unquote, of the husband, too. And you see that in the relationship, and this isn't, I'm not giving it away to any of the audiences, but you'll see how it ties in with the group dynamics of this relationship. It makes you think, you know, you can see yourself in a lot of different people. So it's experiences of both the people.
Good. Well, thanks. Thank you for joining us.
Quite welcome. Happy to be here.
Oh, thank you. Well, now we got next time, we'll have more movie reviews as well as plays and music.
Until then, we have a couple of our own suggestions. Orchestral Maneuvers in the Dark will be performing at the Maurice Richard Arena November 8th. And Love and the Rockets will be performing at the Spectrum on November the 4th. Tickets are on sale now.
We also have another band performing at the Spectrum on November 5th. They're called Shriekback. And the Ligue Nationale d'Improvisation has started its new season. Plays will start every Sunday at the Spectrum, so hurry up and get your tickets.
Well, that's about it for this week. We hope you've enjoyed our first show. Let's make another rendezvous real soon. Bye-bye.
See you then. I'm Norma Gaudio.
I'm Shalini Goel.
Welcome to Rendez-Vous, our entertainment show. This week we have in store for you two very interesting features. Plus we have some movie reviews on very hot movies that are in town this week.
Well, Shalini? Thanks, Norma. Well, besides movies, we're going to be taking a look at some young artists here who perform at Club Jody's, that's on Drummond Street. You might have passed it by on your way to Concordia. Every Monday and Tuesday night. Now, they have something special that they do every Monday night for the Monday Blahs, Monday Night Live. So let's have a look at that.
Is get on my nerves and get on everyone else's nerves. Now, if I was that big old fat
editorialist, man. That's what I'd be saying. I'd be saying, take it easy, man. Smoke a little ganji. Do a couple volume, man. Have a game of golf. Find a good woman, man. No woman, no cry. No woman, no cry. Put in that like different. Bill, put in a hot dog, okay?
Excuse me, man.
Yeah.
Who will you be voting for in this upcoming election?
Oh, Henry Cabbage. Yeah. Oh, hey, Ali, he could have shut me down when he was public health inspector, eh?
And what did Henry J. Cabbage do instead?
He overlooked the rat droppings, the tainted meat, the watered-down booze, and the no fire insurance. Hey, Ali got everything cleared up real good. It didn't cost me that much either. That's why Ali Cabbage is getting my vote. You get good value for your money.
Thank you very much.
Merci.
Salut.
I would like to welcome my first guest tonight. She's the leading soprano soloist for the L'Opéra de Montréal, Mademoiselle Valette Covey. Valette?
C'est un plaisir de ici,
Valette. And Mr. Reed Molester, one of Canada's best loved and best known singers.
Maudit bloc, va. I can't tell you what a thrill to be here, especially with Valette. I'm one of Valette's biggest fans.
Well, I certainly couldn't argue with that, Doreen. Well, what do you ladies have planned for us today?
Eh bien voilà.
Nous allons tout d'abord commencer.
Well, as I see it, our mission today is to bring opera to the man on the street.
Yes, you probably know a lot of men on the street, don't you, Doreen?
You French Canadians are so cute with your lack of understanding of the English language. Why don't you spend a few bucks on some English lessons? Then maybe you'd get work in Upper Canada.
But if I hear what's your sign or any other morning line, I'll go out of my mind.
Oh, men, why do I bother? Why do I care? I think I'll go out of my mind. Oh, men, why do I try? Please tell me why I can't get men of my mind.
Now, is this not getting pathetic?
Anyways, through all this, she turns to me and she says, I want to be sodomized.
What? No, we're just talking about Sodom and Gomorrah.
Right.
I mean, that's where this kid takes place next week.
Right. Okay, just do your ad for next week and please get on with it.
Stay tuned, or tune in next week when this chick called Moby Dickless gets fucked by, she's got great big huge tits, and she gets fucked by Donald Duckless, being knocked in the head by three cunning linguists, while being sold on by the director.
That. I think I'd like to know a little bit more about it. What about you, Norma?
I agree. Yeah. That's a great way to spend
Monday night. Yeah, I'd rather watch that than TV.
Mm-hmm. And here to tell us more about the Full House Theater is Sarah Hayward, director and coordinator of Full House Theater, and Penny Mancuso, who is also performer and collaborator.
Welcome to the show.
Thanks. How did you get started?
Well, Full House, that's the group that's mm-hmm. producing it. Full House Theater Cooperative started two summers ago, and a group of writers and actors and technicians got together and decided we wanted to stay in Montreal instead of moving to Toronto, because all of us had just graduated from professional theater schools mm-hmm. in Montreal, Concordia, mm-hmm. Dawson. And so we decided we had to create our own English theater if we wanted to stay here. So we started the Full House Theater Co-op. Well, actually, Alan Patrick, who was a Concordia graduate, he was the main inspiration. He started the company. And we wanted to do our own brand of humor, like the name Full House sort of indicates that we
do comedy.
Slapstick and spoofing.
Yes, yeah, and mostly like political cabarets are what we like to do, because we can have a say on what's going on around us, a say in the state of the nation, and make fun of our own institutions, and be saying something at the same time as acting and singing and doing the things that we love to do.
Where did you get your name, Monday Night Live? Because when people read the name Monday Night Live, they think it's from, you took your title from Saturday Night Live.
That's right. Well, that's a spoof, because we've taken Monday Night Live, and we also play on Tuesday night, so we're Monday Night Live on Tuesday. Mm-hmm. Also, the whole, the framework of the show is a pirate TV station, and that's CUTV.
Oh, another
so,
spoof.
Yeah, that's another spoof on CUTV. So we're taking off on two things. That way people know the kind of thing that we're doing. Mm-hmm. We're not copying either of them, but we're spoofing both of them. Mm-hmm.
Right. So what this means, Penny, is do you do all your own scripts? I would imagine, Sarah, Penny, either of you, that you must have to write a lot. It sounds kind of original, isn't it?
It's all original material, and we have
a group. Very difficult to do.
It's very difficult. We have a group of six writers and six actors, and we work as a collective. So the writers will write their material, submit it to the actors, and in the two-week period that we have to rehearse the show, we will workshop the material, learn it, and put the show together.
But two weeks
it's
makes
really
it a very hectic schedule. Yeah.
That's because we change every 2 weeks. We have five episodes. We've been running, we've done three episodes now, and we have two episodes left. So it's pretty hectic.
So you go on until when now? I believe you have these shows now, Monday and Tuesday nights. Monday is Monday Night Live, your spoofs, and I'd love to be there for one of those. But when do you run on until? Do you have a certain segment that you do over a period of time and then you change?
Yeah, we have the five episodes.
Mm-hmm.
And so the last episode is December 1st and 2nd.
Uh-huh.
Then we take a rest for Christmas and hopefully remount in the spring with new episodes.
Well, excellent.
Yeah. Also, our shows have themes. Lately we've been working on this theme thing. And we had, like, our second show was around the time of the Reagan-Gorbachev summits, so we had a Soviet special.
Yeah.
And one of our episodes dealt with feminism and female mm-hmm. issues. The one that's coming up this week is a media, a whole media thing. And next week, which will be our last episode, and not next week, the week after, will be our CUTV Arts
Well, it sounds like you guys don't have to worry about censors. What's going on? Don't you have to watch what you're saying?
Well, no, we don't, because I get the material, and as the director, I can censor things if I want to. Mm-hmm. But the whole basis of our show is that the media exploits a lot of situations and also doesn't report on others. You know, there are things you're not supposed to talk about. You can show death and destruction and misery all over the world, but you can't talk about certain subjects and certain things that, you know, you can buy in the drugstore.
So, well, that's an added plus from what we normally get, which is very censored fare. So this is right as it is. I mean, this is exactly the way it's thought and perceived and felt without any kind of
We also editing. Like to get the audience involved, so we have some audience participation. We take suggestions and we do two commercial improvs based on the audience suggestions so that they can see their actual ideas being spoofed.
Have you ever been in a situation where an audience suggested some topic and you can go through with it?
Well, we take about five or six suggestions so that we have a choice.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so sometimes they're really great, and sometimes, you know, you do something that you think's funny and the audience doesn't, but they still appreciate it because you've tried to work on their ideas.
The stage must be set up in a way where you can easily walk into the audience and ask for their opinion and help them.
What is your ambience like, in other words?
Jody's is like a bar. We're only about 3 feet away from the audience.
Right in there.
Plus, we have the mirrors from the discotheque, so we face the mirrors when we perform. Mm-hmm. And we actually, Penny does a segment where she does satellite interviews.
Yeah.
So she uses the mirrors as the satellite, and the performers, or the people she's interviewing, are looking at her in the mirror.
That might be an idea for our show, Norma. Satellite.
Stand in the back.
Yeah, we'll stand over there. You take the mirrors.
Yeah, because we're an impoverished TV station, you know. It's a pirate station with no license, nothing. The studio audience is the only audience because we can't even afford cameras, of course.
Oh, God. But it sounds like it's coming out really, really well.
Has anything gone wrong where you couldn't handle? Is there a moment on stage where you just want to just get off the stage?
So far? Well, see, the thing is that you're learning material so fast.
Mm-hmm. It's just 2 weeks.
Like, you know, you're opening a show like Monday, and it's it's already Friday and we're, oh my God, I've got to write this whole
You have 3 days, really, because by the time the writers have all their submissions and you have 3 days to put it together. So considering that, they've been...
So you have to rely, although there's very little improvisation, it is all scripted. There's been moments on stage where you are into heavy improvisation.
I'm sure the audience probably likes that as much, if not more. Could they tell? Or probably not.
Well, sometimes, but most of the time they get into the spirit of it. Like, we have another segment called Stump the Writer. In the beginning of the show when...
Sounds
when
like David Letterman. Stump the audio person.
But when we go out to get the improvisation suggestions, we also get suggestions from the audience to give to our one of our writers who's always in residence. Mm. And this writer has about, we'll say, 40 minutes to come up with a script to give to the actors who will, for the first time, see it on stage. And that usually ends up being total craziness because we don't know what we're getting, the audience doesn't know, we're reading the stage directions, and total mayhem breaks loose, and it's really worked quite successfully.
Well, it sounds very, very interesting.
You have to catch that.
Yeah, I want to. I'd rather watch this, as I said, over television any day.
It's so very good student fair as well, because we try to hit local issues, local things that are important to students. We've hit, of course, the bus drivers, the strike at the funeral home, any local things, the mayoralty election. Try to hit everyone locally.
So what will you be planning after December the 2nd and your next session? That will be, I think, just after Christmas holidays?
Yeah, probably in January. Well, we have to have a big powwow with the writers and decide on the themes, and it'll be all new stuff again.
Another bar?
Who knows?
Well, Club Jody's is so close. We wouldn't want you to move too soon. It's so close from Concordia.
Thank you for being on the show.
Thank you, Penny. Yeah, we encourage everybody to come and see it.
We will. I'm sure everybody will be interested.
Great.
Okay. So what do we have next lined up?
Well, it's looking at these young artists, Norma. It's easy to see that it's very difficult to get an opening into any kind of artistic fields. So you have to encourage everyone that makes an effort. And certainly, these people are not just making an effort. They're doing a darn good job of it. So what about Concordia? What about our own talented musicians? We have our music club, Concordia. Can we do something for them? Why wait to give them a chance? Let's have a look at this segment.
I have with me Jean-François Denis, the organizer of the 5th series of Electroacoustic Music Festival. He's a teacher here at Concordia in the music department of Electroacoustic, and he's also himself a composer. Hi, Jean-François.
Hello.
The festival is organized by the CECG. What is it?
That's the Concordia Electroacoustic Composers Group. They are an ensemble playing together live electroacoustic music. About 4 or 5 musicians, depending on the situation. They've been together for 5 years in putting the 5th series of concerts. They published a newsletter that was sent to the Canadian electroacoustic community at large. And also they have an archive of electroacoustic music on tape.
Now I'd like you to introduce and explain a little bit what will we see and hear tonight.
Tonight, the concert tonight is the third one of this mini festival. the focus of this festival was computer-assisted music. So at one level or another, a computer is either assisting the performance or controlling the performance of the music.
Okay, what's the difference between the two?
A slight difference, the difference I make in any case, is that computer-assisted music is where the computer is only performing the music, is only helping the performer. Computer-controlled is where the computer is actually making some decisions, such as, well, it could be compositional decisions, it could be moving the sound into the space, things like that, but the computer is responsible for that.
I see.
Electroacoustic music is called as such because its main interest is not the melody, is not rhythm, it's not a groove or chorus or things like this, but it is texture, timbre. It is a study in a way, or a play with sound itself. And it's putting sounds and it's crafting sounds that will go one after the other, or one at the same time in the other. That's electroacoustic music world. There's been, electroacoustic has been around for not even 40 years. It, actually, 36 years. It started in France with Pierre Schaeffer doing music concrète, and at the same time in Germany, Karin Stockhausen started to do electronic music. So that's why we've got conflicting names for the basically the same type of interest, which is the sonic.
Do you think that this music will live always in parallel with the popular music, or do you think that maybe one day it can take its place?
No, I don't think it will take its place ever. I think it's some people in some milieu talk about art music and commercial music. I make the difference between concert music and non-concert music. Electroacoustic music is really meant to be listened to. As for music on the radio, when it's played in the radio in your car, for instance, or in the office or in the elevator, that music wasn't really meant to be listened to. It's just a filler in a way. I'm not saying that those people are not talented or they're not doing a good work. I'm just saying that the work on the audience is very different. They have to listen to it, just as symphonies or contemporary music or Japanese koto for that matter.
So thank you very much, Jean-François, and good luck.
Thank you.
If you are interested with electroacoustic music, there are 5 concerts still coming here at Concordia in the festival. And like you said, the most known composers of electroacoustic music are Pierre Henry and Pierre Schaeffer. Look for their record in the classical section in big record stores. And you can also write to l'Association pour la création et la recherche électroacoustique du Québec, the ACREQ. They produce each year some tapes of Montreal composers, which you can order. And the address is Box 416, Outremont, Québec, H2V 493. For Rendez-Vous, I'm Marie-Hélène Grenier.
After we've taken quite a long look at music and theater, now let's talk about movies. I'm here with Nadina. She's going to tell us about the latest movie of Whoopi Goldberg, Jumping Jack Flash. What do you think about that movie?
I think it's fantastic, not only because Jumping Jack Flash happens to be the funniest movie that I've seen in a long time, but also because it contains some witty rather than mindless humor that we so often find in movies today. The movie, which was written for Whoopi Goldberg, brings out her talent not only as a good comedian, which she naturally is, but also as an actress. In Jumping Jack Flash, Whoopi Goldberg plays a part of Terry, a computer analyst for a large international bank in New York. Early in the movie, we are made aware of Whoopi's talent as a superior computer analyst and the fact that her terminal in the movie picks up Soviet television. This sets the plot, which makes the rest of the movie credible, especially since her computer terminal links up with a British spy trapped in the Soviet Union. And from the moment Terry's computer makes contact with the British spy, the viewer is in for some suspense and some hilarious comedy as Whoopi fights against time and enemy spies to get Jack out of danger.
Whoopi Goldberg seems to give credit to her popularity in this film.
Oh, yes, she does. In this following scene, she has entered the British embassy
during a ball given in honor of Queen Elizabeth II from England without an invitation in order to access the embassy's computer to get Jack out of the Soviet Union. And you'll see how she cleverly manages to get out of difficulties that arise.
Okay, let's take a look at that.
Invitation, please.
I don't have one.
Well, I'm sorry, but we can't let you in without an invitation. You look awfully familiar.
It's because I'm the entertainment.
What on earth?
I need love, love to ease my mind.
Diana.
I need to find someone for my
time.
Like.
I did enjoy seeing Whoopi Goldberg, but I also enjoy a lot of other people, too, in the performances, particularly William Hurt, for one. You might remember him from his last great performance in The Kiss of the Spider-Woman. Coming up more recently is a new movie that he's in, Children of a Lesser God. And to talk with us today about it is James here. James, welcome to the show.
Thank you. Children of a Lesser God really is a brilliant movie, and William Hurt, who usually tackles difficult roles, has taken on this role marvelly, and he's just brilliant. He stars as a teacher for deaf children in a school, and he's newly hired. But this is not what the movie's really about. It's not about teaching handicapped children. It's about, instead, he falls in love with Marley Matlin. Her name is Sarah in the movie. Mm-hmm. The thing is, in the movie, she's deaf, and she doesn't speak one single word. So it's a bit of a challenge acting in that kind of movie. I don't know if she's really deaf or not.
Is Marley a real deaf?
I don't know. Woman? We couldn't find out. If she is, she deserves an Oscar. And if she's just a regular actress, she still had a difficult role and did marvelously well.
Well, it must be interesting for William Hurt to act with somebody like this, because you don't get that feedback in dialogue.
No.
So you might feel a little stilted when you say some of these
No,
lines.
Because, mind you, most of the movie there's a lot of sign language. He had to learn sign language, which was in itself something incredible, because I don't think I could learn it that quickly. And also, he has to translate whatever she says, because whatever she says, unless you know sign language, you're pretty stumped in the audience. So whatever she says, he has to interpret for her. Maybe this takes away a bit from the emotions, strong emotions that she gives out in the movie. But still, it's very difficult and well executed.
Is this movie just another love story, or is there something more to it? Is there a message to the audience?
It's a romance, but it's not a fairy tale romance, I would say. It has meaning. It deals with real issues, real life. It has a real story. I mean, it is credible. You know, you can picture that happening to people. And because she's deaf, it's really more incredible. It's more believable, I should say, maybe. Because most people who can speak can never overcome communication problems like they have in the movie.
True. Did you find William Hurt's acting better in this performance or in Kiss of the Spider-Woman? Now, I'm biased. I prefer Kiss of the Spider-Woman.
Well, I have to say, he was good in both movies. He was really excellent. They're both difficult roles, mind you. I think they both are outstanding. You can't really compare apples and oranges like this. It's really William Hurt. I was never really a William Hurt fan, but now I am. And in the next scene, we're going to see, we have a clip. You really get an idea of how strong the acting is in this movie. So I guess we'll take a look at it now, right?
Okay, let's just break for a little view into that movie.
I tried to call your mother. Hey, hold it. Come on, wait, like I can't. I didn't even talk to her, okay? I mean, can we stop this? Why don't we go out and have some dinner tonight?
Huh? Just give me a yes or a no. Yes? Good. I think. Okay, I will meet you behind the girls' dormitory at 8 o'clock. And I will whisper your name. Hey, I know that sign. That's the first sign I ever learned.
Well, that was very interesting. Thanks, James. Any last closing remarks?
Oh, the cinematography is brilliant, and just that is worth the trip. It's playing at the Westmount Square in Place du Parc, so it's definitely worth going to see at any price.
Well, we thank our critics, James and Nadina, and welcome you back to our show some other time.
Thank you.
But before we go, I'd like to remind you that coming up is, don't forget to watch for Concordia's musicians. For example, on November 20th, we have a student ensemble. Programs are available in the music department at the refectory hall, at the factory building. Shalini?
Okay, and don't forget to watch out for a new movie coming out this week, in the week of November 14th. It's called The Mission. It's a new Robert De Niro movie, and it's starring also Jeremy Irons, and it's pitting a man of the sword with the man of the cloth to save an Indian tribe in South America. Might be interesting. Catch that.
And finally, we have on this campus a Chinese retrospective of cinema. It'll be going on until November 30th, and it'll be featuring 30 movies, Chinese movies, from 1932 till 1985. It is considered the first of its kind in North America.
Great. Well, you have plenty to watch out for. Stay tuned next time with Rendez-Vous.
See you then.